Let me first thank the organizers for having me here. It so far has been a real pleasure, and I hope it will be a prolonged pleasure until the end of the semester. I have no doubt about that. Also, we have actually organized in the last semester, in the fall, we have organized a special semester in a quite close flavor. So I was one of the main organizers there, so I know it's actually a pain in the ass to organize such a thing. And I can really tell you, I utterly enjoy having been switched from organizer to just attendee. It is perfect. When I talk, in workshops in adaptive optics, it's not really astronomy, but it is actually, it helps astronomers obtain very sharp pictures and do good astronomy. So what we are trying to do with adaptive optics is get high quality images of stars, galaxies, whatever you want to image. And this is, of course, a project that runs forever, I would say since the 2028 or something like that, and will stop probably not before I'm retired, I guess. It will not be so soon, I hope. Okay, so let's short overview. The whole thing is all related to the European Extremely Large Telescope, and I will actually talk you a little bit through that. So what is the European Extremely Large Telescope? So this is not an extremely large telescope, nor has I have it. It's a very large telescope here. And the very large telescope is run by ESO, the European Southern Observatory. And this is the part of Europe where the UK is still part of. UK is a member of ESO and pays its dues every year. But that ESO actually builds and operates astronomical telescopes, and in the southern hemisphere, mainly in Chile. So this very large telescope here, consisting of four telescopes, each with a diameter of 8 meters, is in the Atacama Desert in Chile, and it's one of the most efficient telescopes that is actually run worldwide. Our whole story actually started in 2008 when Austria decided to join ESO, and then somehow, you know, you join kind of a club and you have to pay something, like an entrance fee. And one of our projects here was this entrance fee. There was this scientific contribution, mathematical algorithms and software for ELT adaptive optics, and it was somehow a first study that the mathematics is actually able to run the real-time computation necessary to run this telescope. So in 2014, there was a final decision to build the Extremely Large Telescope. So that's the sketch of the Extremely Large Telescope. And since, I think, 2015, they really started to construct it. So I'm just going to show you a few pictures. Well, that's actually the telescopes that are currently available. Well, I mean, or going to be available. This here is the Extremely Large Telescope. And you see also the scale. The Extremely Large Telescope here is by far the biggest one. So that's the Very Large Telescope that already exists. The Keck Telescope, that's the one which are in Hawaii. The 30-meter telescope, that's the American attempt. And when we started to work on that, there was kind of a close fight who's going to be the first one that actually gets first light. So the Americans didn't even start constructing. They don't even know where to put it. So the ELT will be the sole 30-meter telescope around. The Grand Canadian telescope is here, the Subaru, the GMT is there. So, and this, they are currently, constructing it, but it's actually on the top of a mountain and 3,000 meters elevation it's going to be built. So here in Chile, so as you see, right in the middle of nowhere, so they have this mountain, and that is about 3,000 meters high. They flattened the top, and the foundations are already there, so you can actually go on the ESO webpage and you will see how it's actually going to grow day by day. And one of the reasons that they have to build it here is that it's really dry. You see that in the background, nothing green. So it never rains, not only in California, but there it almost never rains. Okay. Wrong direction again. Yeah, as I said, it's going to be Europe's eye to the universe, and it will be really the largest optical or near infrared telescope that will be available. When we started, it was something like planned for 42 meters before the main mirror, and could actually cost about 1 billion euro. When they really started to build it, they were actually reassessing the costs, and they're realizing, okay, now for 1 billion euro, we only get 39 meters. So it's now a 39 meter telescope. They still call it 40 meter plus telescope, so it sounds completely right. Anyway, so it's a kind of telescope that's a little bit like the standard microscope that you had in school. So you have the main cover on top, and then you have different objectives down there that you can move. So what we have here are different instruments which are in the ELT, actually located in the ELT dome. And what we are doing is we are developing methods, mathematical methods, software for the adaptive optics systems, of in particular these two instruments here, METIS, that is actually this instrument, and MIKADO, that's down here. So METIS actually operates in the infrared spectra, so from about 2.5 micrometer up to 20 micrometers or something like that. MIKADO more in the visible light. And this is, so for all these instruments, we have relatively large instrument from software that we build and construct this instrument. And the idea is somehow the scientists provide the instruments, and then in return, they get light for the astronomers to observe. So you have to take into account that one light observing at the ELT will be about 150,000 euros. So it's quite costly to be here, so this is kind of an in-time, and we are working for the instruments here. We are much faster. The first light is supposed to be in 2026. We couldn't actually wait so long, so we constructed our own telescope. And I can tell you that really, for my PhD students, they never spent so long at during that time when we built that together. So that was, they spent hours and hours over time. And it's really nice to have this. Okay, so principle of adaptive optics. For those of you that don't know how it works, or what is the reason why it could work, like we're talking, a telescope is an optical system. And each, so the imaging process of an optical system is, from the mathematical point of view, always the same. Each optical system has a point spread function, and what you actually get out of the optical system, the image that you get, is the original convolved with the point spread. And if you look at the point spread function of a telescope, there's nothing, no atmosphere, nothing else, so like a telescope that is in space. And the point spread function is nothing more like the characteristic function of a telescope, that is a donut. And then you take the Fourier transform and the absolute value and square it, and that's the point spread function. So for the VLT, that's the point spread function for the 8-meter telescope. And for the EAT, it's going to be the point spread function for 40 meter telescope. So it's clear why you actually build larger telescopes, because the larger the telescope, the more the point spread function here resembles a delta distribution, which means, well, if you really have a delta distribution, the image that you get out is the image that you really want to have. So that was also the reason why not only we are thinking about the EAT with the 40 meter telescope, but I also thought about building the overwhelmingly large telescope with a diameter of 100 meters. I realized the technique at the moment is not available, so they can't take it. So we are stuck with the 40 meters. Anyway, the problem is now that we are talking about a telescope which is not in space, but on a mountaintop. So you have between the telescope and the space or the object here, the atmosphere. In the atmosphere, you have turbulence, and then the point spread function actually changes. So you have now, here again, the characteristic function of the telescope, and there you have this exponential term here,
And the psi is a function that is related to the turbulence in the atmosphere. And what actually happens is that the turbulence, well, look at the point spread function here, no peak anymore. So the turbulence actually destroys everything that you gain with the last telescope, the turbulence destroys. Well, fortunately, they have thought about that and developed adaptive optics. So the first idea about adaptive optics was actually in 1952. It took a long time to really make it run. So, and if you correct the adaptive optics, you get your peak back. So what is still the problem? The problem is that the point spread function depends on the turbulence above the telescope, and the turbulence above the telescope changes every, let's say, 2 milliseconds. Which means the point spread function changes every 2 milliseconds. So you have basically your image here is a sum of part of the image here convolved with a time dependent point spread function. So, and you have here maybe about 60,000 time steps. So one single imaging process can take everything from 10 seconds to 20 minutes. So lots of change in the atmosphere during that time. Okay, so now what is adaptive optics? Adaptive optics is a technique for correcting optical distortions arising during the imaging process. It's kind of really a hardware-based blurring. So what you do is you have some light coming from a bright star, from a bright guide star. This is disturbed by the atmosphere. It falls onto a deformable mirror. It's a mirror that can actually change the shape within 1 millisecond, 2 milliseconds. And this is the correction process. And then you have a beam splitter here. So most of the light goes to your camera. A part of it goes to a waveform center and a control system that actually determines the shape of the deformable mirror in the next time step. So it actually looks a little bit like. Doesn't matter, I have a nice movie that shows how that actually works. The point is that actually the light from the guide star, you measure it every 2 milliseconds, and you have also to change the shape of this deformable mirror within this 2 milliseconds. So that means you have a correction, you have to do a correction in real time, so at around 500 to 3000 hertz, depending on the application that you're actually going to do. So what are the different operating modes that you have? So there are different systems around. So the basic operating system is actually single convolute adaptive optics. So you have that here, the image, the object you want to actually image. You need a bright light star to correct, that you actually can use for the correction. And then you get a very sharp image that is from the bright light, with the head of this bright light star, and you can actually see this object quite sharp. So the point is, of course, that you don't have bright light stars always near to some object you're interested in, so that's where tomography comes into game. So you have several light stars around, some you place several light stars around an object, I'll tell you a little bit later how that works, and then you can basically image every object that you want to see in a sharp way. That would be the laser tomography system. Multi-conjugate adaptive optics is basically the same. So you have several guide stars do a tomography of the atmosphere above your telescope. And by doing so, you can actually image several objects or a large object at the same time. And for multi-object adaptive optics, you can actually do several mirrors for each object that you are interested in, and you can correct for each separate. Okay, so let's come to the first invention that is actually related to the so-called waveform reconstruction. And I will just go straight to the two sensors that we are looking at, the Sacher-Harpmann and the Pironic sensor. So what is the problem here? So you have your reference star, that's again the bright light star. You know it because the star is so far away, you can get infinity, the incoming light, the wavefronts of the incoming light are plain, but unfortunately it goes then to the atmosphere, and the atmosphere has a reflective indicator that depends on temperature, and if you have a temperature changes in there, so the travel times are different. So the wavefronts are not plain anymore, but they look more like a crumpled sheet of paper. So we have here these variations in there. And then we have actually this wavefront sensor on the ground that basically records the wavefronts, the shape of the wavefronts, and with help of the ground conjugator to form the mirror you would like to connect. So how do these wavefront sensors actually look like? Well, the easiest one and the most common one is the so-called Fock-Hartmann sensor. The Fock-Hartmann sensor consists of a square array of small lenses. That's the small lenses. And what actually happens is to hear the lenses, if a plane wavefront falls onto this array of lenses, well, you get from the bright star, that's the small images from each of the bright stars from each of these lenses. And if the wavefront is plane, they are all nicely centered where they should be. Now, if the wavefront is actually perturbed, then the image that you get looks a little bit more like that. And the deviation of the center of the point in X and Y direction is related to the gradient of the incoming wavefront. So, a typical model that you can use to describe the measurements that you actually get from the Fock-Hartmann sensor is what you measure is the average of the wavefront coming in, the gradient of the wavefront coming in at each time step. So, in order to reconstruct the wavefront, and you would need the wavefront in order to correct the form of the mirror, basically, in this setting, the negative wavefront would be the shape of the deformable mirror that you have to put in order to correct and sharpen the image. So the first and last problem would be, well, get this file here, the incoming wavefront, from the measurements of the Fock-Hartmann sensor. At the moment, much more in is the so-called pyramid wavefront sensor. And the pyramid wavefront sensor is much more complicated, it's much more sensitive, but it's mathematically much more complicated. It has been chosen for most of the instruments of the EAT, so the Medit and Carado, and in particular for extreme adaptive optics, and extreme adaptive optics is used, for instance, for finding planets, exoplanets. And you can imagine, I mean, exoplanets are, we have the star here, they are very close to the star, far away, they are very close, and they have really problems to find them. And you need a very high imaging quality, meaning you need a very good adaptive optics there. So in this case, you have not only 2 milliseconds for one reconstruction, but you have to change not only in 2 milliseconds the surface of your deformable mirror, but you have to do it in 0.3 milliseconds. So you have a rate of 1,000 teraflops for your reconstruction. And you have also very fine deformable mirrors with lots of actuators that you have to control. So it's a problem from a computational point of view. So you have to solve an inverse problem, a full inverse problem, every 0.3 milliseconds. And the last one. So, what is a pyramid sensor? It's basically, you have here kind of a pyramidal prism, here, so that's the optical element, and the wavefront actually falls on top of the pyramidal prism and creates here 4 images, and out of these 4 images, you form these data as X and as Y, so basically it's some kind of average, some differences of these 4 images, so these 2 sets of data, and you can also do that, you can decouple it a little bit, instead of having a prism, you take 2 rooms which are orthogonal to each other, and you get decoupled images here, and then you get the same kind of data. So what is the model? So for a non-modulated pyramid wavefront sensor, there will be a pyramid wavefront sensor that looks exactly like here, it's 6. The model is basically the sum of 2 integral equations, non-linear integral equations, both for Sx and Sy, and the task would be given these measurements you have to observe with integral equations. But sometimes it's going to be used as a pyramid wave function or circle of modulation, that if you have, instead of falling, instead of the wave function and tip of the pyramidal prism all the time, it's actually rotated, or the pyramid wave function that is rotated, and by doing so, it's getting a little bit more stable. So that's something that they found out, the engineers, and so you can also do a modeling of that. Basically, it looks a little bit the same, but then you have here another better function that comes into the game, and here in the second term, you have a function f, which is also not, you can actually compute it, but it makes everything a little bit more complicated. And the first thing that you actually do when you want to do the reconstruction is you drop the second, always the second part of the integral equation. You don't want to do three times integration, so that's taking far too long. So, with all our reconstruction methods, basically, it's either in this operator or in this operator. Yeah, so the inverse problem here clearly is you have some waveform sensor measuring process, you have the data S, and you have some of these, if you have this operator T, that's sort of the waveform sensor operator, it could be the one for the Hartmann sensor, it could be the one for the pyramid sensor. And you have to solve this problem every, let's say, 1 to 2 milliseconds. And I'm not going into details how we are going to do that, but we developed for the Hartmann sensor, we developed a nice reconstructor that basically does some cumulative integration of the data and get some nice results. And you get here for the 8-meter telescope, you get really nice reconstruction of the equivalent above the telescope and works quite nicely. This has already been done more than 10 years ago. Also for the pyramid sensor, you can do almost the same algorithm, the thing is a little bit modified. You can also get a nice reconstruction. And these are the baseline that actually hopefully will be running on the telescope just for the baseline reconstruction. Okay, so just that you have an idea about speed. The interesting thing is, I hope, I'm not going to offend any astronomers. Astronomers are usually very, very innovative when they think about problems in astronomy. When they deal, on the other hand, with engineering problems and have to think about methods how to solve them, they're extremely conservative. They use exactly the methods that they know best, that they learn at university, and have really problems in adapting to something else. So, like for the ELT, what they still want to do, our partners, they want to do everything in logic vector multiplication. So they want to set up everything as a huge matrix, and then they always want to simply use a reconstructor that simply does a matrix. So they want to, this matrix, they want to invert, of course, with some whatever method, and then they want to do a matrix vector multiplication. Regardless what you tell them, they say, but we know that. We know that works, and everything else is kind of tricky. Anyway, so we try to convince them, and like, if you do really try to reconstruct them with a standard matrix vector multiplication, then it takes something like 402 milliseconds. Just 2 milliseconds. With our method, we are going below, let's say, below 1,000 microseconds, 500 microseconds. So it's really fast. The answer, if we heard this argument in the last talk, the answer is, yeah, but by the time, when the ELT is ready, we have much bigger computers. We can do the computation much, much, much faster. They don't say that anymore. They say, no, we do it on the GPU. So one of my PhD students tried to put it on the CPU, and the bottleneck simply gets the data into the GPU, and and trying to use a GPU there, but there's at the moment no GPU available that would actually be able to store the matrices, get the data, and everything else. But still, it's fine. Anyway, so our algorithms do the trick. So that's the nice thing. And second part I want to talk about is atmospheric tomography. And then going again for the system and models, and then I do a little bit math here and also a little bit numeric. Let's see. So again, what do we have? And I'm mainly talking about multi-convergent adaptive optics here. So we have multiple waveform sensors that can receive signals from multiple reference paths. We have several layers of covalences there, and we have several deformable mirrors that can connect the covalences in different altitudes above the telescope. So that's what we have. Basically, what we have to do is first we have to reconstruct the covalence, and then second we have to compute a projection of this reconstructed covalence to the deformable mirrors. So that's what it's going to be. So this instrument is the one that we are trying to get some nice software implemented on. That's the multi-convergent adaptive optics relay for the ELT observations, MOFIO. So the astronomers are always really good in finding some abbreviations for these very complicated names. So this is really the setting here. We have 9 waveform sensors. We have 6 laser guide stars, and just telling you about laser guide stars a little bit later. We have 3 natural guide stars, and we have 3 deformable mirrors with lots of actuators in order to deform the deformable mirror. And the aim is here, of course, having a good waveform correction over a large field of view. What we have to do is get the tomography done. It's, of course, totally useless with the data that we have available to reconstruct the full volume above the telescope. We simply have not enough measurements to do that. But fortunately, as you know, when you actually board a plane and the plane starts, there are areas in the air where there are turbulences, and in between it's quite smooth, nothing happens. So what you can do is you can model the turbulences in the atmosphere as layers located at different heights above the telescope. What the astronomers are actually doing there is they sending up balloons and measure exactly once per day where these turbulent layers are exactly located. So that's at least the plan. So we have these layered atmosphere, and we measure actually the accumulated turbulence in these directions here down here. So assuming dramatic propagation, the model that we have for the measured data in direction alpha d, so that would be the direction that we are measuring, is simply you sum up the shifted turbulences, what we actually see with the telescope, so these circuits here, you sum that up and that's your data. For the modeling, we take usually something like 35 layers of the atmosphere. For the reconstruction, we use something like 3 to 9 layers for the reconstruction. Again, and basically, it's a kind of limited angle tomography problem, taking into account the specific setting that you have a continuous model at a continuous layered model. So that's exactly what you would get when you take as an undersphere, the Laurent transform, and put that model in to do this kind of modeling. So what is the reconstruction approach then? The reconstruction approach that we are following is you have the waveform sensor measurements. You always have first to take the waveform sensor measurements. That's not the input for the tomography. So you have to reconstruct from the waveform sensor measurements. You have to reconstruct the incoming waveforms. And you do the atmospheric tomography. So you see something like 12 images coming in, 6 waveform sensor measurements, and then you get here, like 9 reconstructions for the layers, and out of these reconstructions for the layers, you get the reconstruction to the deformable mirror state. You apply that to the deformable mirror, and then you get the correction. the point is always everything that we do here needs time. So from getting the data measured to doing the reconstruction to actually getting the shape of the deformable mirror to actually really make the deformable mirror move, it takes something like 2 milliseconds. Which means you have always a delay of at least 2 milliseconds. Means you correct the incoming waveform with the data that you have actually had 2 milliseconds before. Meaning you make a mistake. But it's still okay. It still works quite nicely. But it's just to say you will never ever have a perfect reconstruction simply because of the time delay. There's another significant point. If you need guide stars that actually are bright enough. If you count the number of bright stars which are bright enough, they would actually cover something like 5% of the night sky, which is not enough. The solution is you use lasers. So around the EAT, there will be 6 very powerful lasers that shoot laser beams into the sky, so really like Star Wars or whatever you want to have. So you have a layer, a sodium layer in about 90 kilometers high in the atmosphere, and these lasers actually create dive stars, artificial dive stars in 90 kilometers. And they actually can act as your guide star for the reconstruction. And so, by doing so, you can basically actually image every object that you want to see. There are, of course, some problems. One is the tone effect. Normally, the guide stars, the natural guide stars, they are at infinity. So, meaning the light comes really in a cylinder. Here from the laser, 90 kilometers is far away, but still it's not infinity. So it travels here in a cone, which means you have here another parameter down that you have to take into account. That's actually not a big point. What is more complicated is that the light from the real guide star comes from outside the atmosphere and travels through the atmosphere. The light from the laser guide star actually travels up and travels down again. So it means it actually goes twice to the atmosphere, and that means when you see the laser guide star, it's somewhere there. In reality, it might be there because you don't know which path it actually went through the atmosphere because it goes two ways. So you have there is some information missing, and you cannot get this kind of information. That's why they actually always use a combination of laser guide stars and natural guide stars. You need from this natural guide star less information, but in this combination, you get actually all the information that you need. Okay, so now a little bit mathematics. The first thing is, sorry, the whole thing is not unique. Which is quite clear if you look at these pictures, some geometric. There are just some dramatic arguments. Like if you look at what happens here, what happens here, and what happens here, you sum that up. You have no contribution from other directions in this area. So basically, as long as the sum is the same in this direction, you don't get uniqueness by just from this data. And also, if you take other data around it, it won't help unless you have an infinite number of guide stars that would help, but we don't have. So it's not unique. Something which is not so bad is tomography operators are mostly, most cases are compact. In this case, because of the specific structure and the layers here, this atmospheric tomography operator that we actually look at is not compact. It is not compact, which still means it's pretty, it's still in a sense, imposed at the singular values will be very small, but they don't go to zero. There are some conditions where they would actually go to zero, but in most, they don't. Okay. What we want to look at is we would like to have some singular value decomposition of these operators, And the first approach that we did was that we simply looked at this operator on the square domain. The square domain is always because mathematicians like to do. If they don't have a handle how to handle the real domain, so we just look at square. So we started looking at square. We considered periodized raised ones, and we started looking at exponential basis functions, the e to the I here, kx and ky, and we have these nice properties, of course, that sums in the argument transfer to products in the functions, and by doing so, what we came up with is that some older results, of course, in 2016. So if you actually take the waveforms and the area, represent everything in Fourier series, you collect the coefficients in this kind of vectors here, and then you set up some matrices, AJK and DJK. These matrices here actually are quite low dimensional. So D is the number of light stars, that would be 46. L is the number of layers, maybe 9. So this is a 6 by 9 matrix. This would put here a 6 by 6 matrix. Then you actually can decompose the tomography operator, the atmospheric tomography operator AA star applied to the data here. And simply it's a sum, an infinite sum, of course. We have this low dimensional matrices DJK, or in this case AJK, applied to vector, and then you multiply the this function. So this is just a representation. But why is this representation actually useful? This representation is useful because in order to get the eigenvalues of the operators, or the singular values of the tomography operator, what we have to do is, we have to take the small matrices, 69, 66, have to compute numerically the eigenvalues of the small matrices, but of course, in principle, for all. And if you compute all these eigenvalues, then you have the eigenvalues, the singular values of the operator. So you have actually broken down the problem of computing an infinite number of eigenvalues by computing still an infinite number of eigenvalues of small matrices that you actually can really assess numerically. That actually works quite nice. And of course, if you have that, then you get this representation, so you have right for standard singular value decomposition. You have the eigenvalues, that's the eigenvalues of the matrix DJK here. So you have the eigenvalues lambda JK. You have the inner product, the basis function that we define here. So nothing really difficult happens here. And you have the standard singular value type decomposition, or the singular eigenvalue decomposition here. Also, you get a reconstruction for it. So also, standard that we would have for compact operators anyway, but we are not compact. So, but we have still something like something that looks similar. If you look at the similar ways of A, just to print them, I mean, there are the smaller ones here, just in the middle, you have problems, they are really small. Here, you actually see this eigenvalue distribution where the light star directions are. And the nice thing is actually really, if you look at the distribution of the singular values, you have something like 0.64% of the eigenvalues, which are zero. And then if you look at the number of eigenvalues, which are larger than 10 to the power minus 12, it's already 99.34. But if you actually go to larger than 1 to the power minus 2, it's still 97%. Larger than this threshold. So most of the eigenvalues are large enough, which is nice for the inversion. Maybe just very fast before I come to the numerics. We did everything now on a square, this paradise waveform, which is not very realistic. So we would like to have really the donut shaped telescope geometry. And in order to do that, we have to move to frames. And for those of you who don't know frames, frames are functions which can represent any other function, but they're not autonomous anymore, so you need a there, not uniqueness anymore, but in principle it just works in the same way. And what you actually can show is that the exponential functions that we considered before, they are of course not on the normal basis anymore for the realistic telescope geometry, but they still form a frame. So we still can actually decompose any function on the telescope geometry with respect to frames. This frame formed by this exponential function. And we can actually do a very similar analysis as we did before, and we get again a decomposition here that looks like our singular value decomposition that we had before. So here we have the function omega zero k, that's our exponential function that is now only on the donut. And what we need to compute is the so-called dual frame for this frame function, which is numerically a little bit complicated to do, but you can do that, and then you get again a nice reconstruction. We are not using that for the real reconstruction, of course, but what we are doing is we are doing the reconstruction with a weighted-based algorithm. But the idea was then to use a weighted basis for representing the turbulence layer. Why could we do that? But the main point was originally that we know that in the frequency domain, the wavelets have a fast decay, so it would be good to approximate the wavefront or the turbulence layer by wavelets. But what later happened is that we realized that the covariance matrix of the statistics of the atmosphere, we have an idea how the statistics of the atmosphere is, this covariance matrix is in a wavelet basis diagonal, which is really nice for the computation. So for these computations, we always use WC3 wavelets. And yeah, how do we do that? So we want to solve the tomography operator, the operation A phi with S. We do everything in a Bayesian framework. So the question would be, we have some noisy measurements given, so and we want to find that phi that occurs with highest probability. And if you move that into the setting of a maximum a posteriori estimate, what you have to do is you have to minimize this functional here. So here's our tomography operator. This is the covariance matrix of the statistics of the atmosphere. This is the covariance matrix of the noise statistics. And what we did then is we discretized by using bases. So we moved from layers in a bilinear basis, for instance, to basis coefficients. And so in order to this C5 here, this term can be very nicely decomposed with the help of the Bernstein-Jackson inequality into a diagonal matrix applied to this weighted density. So we end up basically here in this linear equation that we have to solve. So that's the atmospheric tomography operator on the weighted basis, which is unfortunately not sparse. Diagonal operator here, the weighted basis is sparse, but in a not weighted basis, it would be not sparse. So what can we do is, well, we connect everything with the weighted transform. Okay, so we combine everything with the wavelet transform, and the nice thing about the wavelet transform is O of n, so it's really fast, and it doesn't really add to the numeric code. So solving that is quite nice. Finally, what we have to do is we have to actually, reconstruct more layers, but in this case, we reconstruct more layers as we have the n. We have to project onto the VM. It's solving another optimization problem, which is not so complicated. Otherwise, if we just reconstruct as many layers as the VM, we simply have the inverse basis transform to apply, and then we are done. How do we solve that? I'm not going into details here. We use some deconjugated conjugate gradient method for that. The number of runtime and the number of iterations are quite crucial for the runtime. We use some Jacobi preconditioners, some modified Jacobi preconditioners for the preconditioning of the system, and in order to speed up everything, some kind of augmented truth or trust-based method where you actually use some information that you have from the previous source, you use that for building a new approximation. And if you combine everything, not into the details here, just for then you get nice reconstruction, and then there comes something that I don't understand at all. So one of my PhD students did a full parallelization of everything, so it works really nice. And to do the simulation, you have somehow the quality criteria here is the so-called Sterrell ratio. The Sterrell ratio is a value between 0 and 100%, or 0 and 1, depending on how you want to do it. And 1 means you get the same imaging quality as you would get without an atmosphere. So 1 is the best you can get. And there are different test settings. I'm not going into the detail here, but this is actually what you get when you have, when you look at the Sterrell ratio reconstruction, and the Sterrell ratio that you get for reconstruction, when you actually reconstruct 3 layers out of 35, which are located on the same height as the deformable mirrors. So you get a center Sterrell ratio of 55% here. If you reconstruct 9 layers and do a projection onto the 3 mirrors, you get a little bit more, but if you look at the runtime, in this case, you get a little bit more, but you need much longer. So the 1.5 milliseconds is what you have available. The 8 milliseconds, that would be more like less weight if you have computers which are 5 years faster than what you have now. There's another, just some conclusions. This is definitely a very good reconstructor, high quality, and it's very fast. The dual domain discretization really works very nice. And you really can do everything with off-the-shelf CPU. So we don't need some special computing system for doing that. And what I want to finish with is what we are doing at the moment. The first thing is we are working with Inas Arquette in Italy together to get that Polymorphio instrument running. We also make tests with the Tech Observatory in Hawaii, looking how our algorithms work there. Also, this is here, that's actually the deformable mirror. From our partner that actually built the deformable mirror. What we are doing there is that we're trying to build a digital twin of this deformable mirror. That we really get, given some voltages that we actually apply, we really can compute and model the shape and surface of this deformable mirror. And what is even more fun is a new project called Alaska. It's about satellite communication. But ESA, not ESO, that the same ESA wants to do is they want to use telescopes, their telescopes on the Canary Islands, to communicate with satellites. Basically, transforming internet, exchange data with the satellite, and they do that by sending a laser up to the satellite. In order, basically, the laser encodes all the information, like in a table, right? So gives you data, but you need again adaptive optics to focus the laser. Otherwise, when it comes to the laser, it would be totally spread out, and we couldn't make use of that. So what we are doing at the moment is we are trying to use our method to get a nice communication between the telescope here from ESA and Tenerife and the satellites that we are going to use for the data communication. So that's, I guess, almost all. Maybe last sentence, everything what I told you now was adaptive optics for astronomy. We are also doing the same kind of applications for ophthalmology, so for eye imaging. So when you want to when you want to image the retina of the eye, so you send a laser in the eye. Very scary. I did that once. I was sitting there and they were just pointing the laser into my eye. I didn't like it. Anyway, but it's the same. Your eye is somehow turbulent, and in order to get really good image of the retina, you have to do something. Adaptive optics. And the same also is a big deal these days in microscopy. So the different elements, you know, like SMMs here, that they are using just for correction. But it's a big deal, not only in astronomy, but astronomers are the first that did their, that did actually make happen. So, and I guess that's it. Thank you.